In Jesus' name we pray. Almighty Father, we thank you once again for the grace and the mercy you are giving to us to present before you once again. We cannot count or start numbering your mercy and the endurance, everything you have had on us. Oh mighty Father, you come with all humility, without any excuse, oh Lord, to come and praise your name, to come and thank you for driving safely, for being at home and not in the hospital, for able to eat without we being fed. We thank you, oh Lord, for able to walk, and then they are not asking or for riding or wheelchair. We thank you, oh Lord, for able to open our eyes, use our tongue, use our teeth, use everything you have given to us without attention of any other neighbor. Oh mighty Father, accept our thanks in Jesus' name. We glorify your name because of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding you are giving every one of us in your word, and let us grow. We pray by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, when the roll call shall be called in the end of the race, I pray we will not find any one of us missing in Jesus' name. Father, you have taught us how to be praying for everybody, including our leaders, including their family, that there's no one that does not need prayer. We pray in any area, devil is waiting for them to cheat them, to slide them down, to defeat them. We pray by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, you are going to intervene in Jesus' name. Lord, you have selected them. We pray that your anointing will continue to be upon them in Jesus' name. By the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, no one among them will regret for serving you in Jesus' name. You bring all their children under you, under your guardians. I pray no one among them will spoil the good things, the foundation they are laying in Jesus' name. Almighty Father, we use that as an opportunity for every one of us here in Charlottesville. We bring all things that belong unto us, from our wife, our children, our sibling, our family. By the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, life of everybody, we continue to praise your name in Jesus' name. By the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, we will not be found wanting at the land as the last day in Jesus' name. Lord, the grace to go, to grow from higher to higher until we get to your throne, you will give to every one of us in Jesus' name. The work you are giving us in Charlottesville, we need wisdom, we need understanding. As the work is spreading, challenges are coming. We pray by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, wisdom and understanding to help us so that we will not surrender to our own will, but your own will, and to the will of human being, but your own way. Father, you will give to us in Jesus' name. Oh, mighty Father, we pray. You are the one that selected us. And as our visitors have said, that the stone that is being rejected is becoming pillar in the house. We pray by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, our pillar will not become caterpillar. When I say caterpillar, the larva stage of butterfly in Jesus' name. Your name is going to be continuing to be glorified in our life in Jesus' name. From more than expectation, you have spread the name of Deeper Life Bible Church Charlottesville to the extent that, I don't want to say fear, but belief that something must be done so that the church can be in the standard, so that people who are watching it outside will not believe that the standard of the church worldly. I pray by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, you are the only one, including those people whom you are going to send to help us, by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, to the standard that will glorify your name and the holiness will continue to be there. Father, you will help us in Jesus' name. Lord, all the assignments, all you have given to us, by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, including those people who are our leader, you will speak to them about it in Jesus' name. By the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, that what they are looking at, that we are looking for name, and the name is spreading, that we are just looking for publicity, and we are gaining it. But we believe that this is the area we started, and you are promoting us. We pray by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, any negative thoughts from ourselves, in our mind, Lord, you see our sincerity. I pray by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, in agreement with every one of us that here this morning, you will crush them in Jesus' name. We bury all self-interest, all self-center, all self-promotion, all self that I must be known. But we come with the heart, we take this job from the beginning to the extent to this level that is growing. We pray by the power and the blood of Jesus. You that started it, you will end it in Jesus' name. We pray by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ for all those people who are in control. And we need to agree. We need to surrender so that it will not be as if we are following all our own ambition. I pray by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, as you are giving us the assignment, you are going to open their eyes to support us in Jesus' name. And by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, from grace to grace, it shall be for us in Deeper Life Bible Church of Charlottesville in Jesus' name. And we continue to call upon you for all areas we might have been wounded, that devil might have want to be bringing before you, that you said you are going to use these people, but look at this. And then the fear will even be coming among the leaders. But I pray, you that you said Jacob you love, Esau you hate, and you have given us the mandate that this is what I want you to do, and we are pursuing it with sincerity of mind. By the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, you will back us up in Jesus' name, and your grace is going to be sufficient. Thank you, O Lord, because you are the Lord that answers prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's open our hymn book to 94. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me, but I long to rise in the arm of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. There are eyes of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the precious bleeding side.
Thank you.
Let us be seated. As usual, by the grace of the Lord, today is the last Sunday of the month, and we are going to listen to one of the pastors' message on the workers' training. As you are listening, I want you to go unto the Lord, that God will speak to you. By the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, you will not leave this place empty-handed. Humble yourself before God, that God is your will at once, not my way. In all area of my life, open my eyes, let me see. Open my ear, let me be able to hear you. Open my eyes to obey your word. Call upon him, call upon him. That God, as we said in the workers meeting yesterday, make me different. Among all other people, Father, separate me and let your name be glorified. Call upon him, surely he will answer your prayer.
Word victory down. We're talking on the source of inner strength. That is, how do I really have this courage? I want you to write the word victory down. But write it from top to bottom. V, I below it, C below it, T below it, O below that, R below that, and Y below that. Like that, straight. You understand that? Right victory, but don't write it from left to right. Write it from the top to the bottom. Have you seen that now? Now, to have victory in our lives, I want to use that word victory and the letters of that word victory and that V, right vigilance in front of that. Vigilance. If the soldier is going to have victory, he must be vigilant. Keep his eyes opened. He must watch the enemy. He must watch his own heart. He must watch his own eating habits. He must watch his exercises. He must be vigilant over the enemy and over himself. And vigilant over his weapon, that nobody takes his weapon away from him. If we're going to have victory, we must be vigilant. Watch the enemy. Watch and pray. Because the enemy, the devil, runs about, goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. I is for instruction. That soldier, if he's going to win victory, while the captain is giving instruction out, he must listen to those instructions. He must understand those instructions. He must practice those instructions. Are we going to have victory on the battlefield? Christ has given us instruction. Is the captain captain of our salvation. He is the one that has never lost any battle. He knows where the enemy is hiding. He knows the thing that can easily make us to fall. And therefore he is giving us instruction in his word. Read those instructions every day. A man that bought a car and will not read the manual, the instruction on how to take care of that car, how to use that vehicle, that vehicle will run down. That vehicle will be destroyed before the real money that you spent on it has actually been spent. Somebody is sick. He went to the hospital. They gave him some pills together with instruction on how to use the pills. He did not listen to the instruction very well. He can kill himself. We must listen to the instruction given in the word of God, the commandments, the warnings, so that we obey. Number one, be vigilant. Number two, I is for instruction. C is for consecration and commitment. The soldier on the battlefield, if he is not consecrated and committed, every time that he is on the battlefield, he will be crying like a baby. My wife is now at home, and because I have to fight as a soldier, I am missing my wife a lot. Mommy is now at home. I wonder how they are doing now without me. My children, I wonder now whether other children in the yard are beating them. That man is not committed to that battle. He'll be an absent-minded fighter. He might die. He'll be having self-pity every time. As an evangelist, you're going to have the victory. Don't have self-pity. Have consecration. And say, this is what I've committed my life to, and I will do it. It may rain, it may be hot, I may have to sleep in the hut in the village, I may not be able to get all the food I need every time. This is my life's goal. Only one life. And I want that life to be committed to something serious that has eternal reward. Consecration and commitment. T is for trusting in the Lord. Trusting in the Lord. Trust those promises. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And when you have that trust in the Lord, and you know that if he needs to send an angel, he will send an angel to protect me. He says, I am precious in his sight. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. He says, I'm the apple of his eyes. He says, I'm a peculiar treasure even unto him. And he says, I'm with you till the end of the world. Why should I fear? When Christ is behind me and Christ is before me, and he says, I'm the one that holds onto the seven candlesticks, and he says, says, I know my sheep, and no man is able to pluck them out of my hand. And he says, I go to heaven to prepare a place for you. When I finish, I'm coming back for you. Why should I be afraid? Why should I run from the battle? He that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Anytime there is difficulty, remember the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me in the path of righteousness, for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. But don't you see those enemies? Yes, I see them. But I see beyond the enemies. I see my shepherd. And he prepares a table before me. In the presence of my enemies, he anoints my head. And my cup runs over. Are you not afraid that evil will follow after you? No, my shepherd is thinking about me. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Are you not afraid at the end of all this preaching? He will throw you away and you'll even go to hell? No, not at all. I will dwell in his house forever. Trust in the Lord. That's how to have the victory. You are vigilant. Then you pay attention to instruction. You have commitment and consecration. You are trusting in the Lord. You are obeying the Lord. That's all in victory. Those soldiers, if they have hearing problem, they cannot go to the battle to fight. Apart from the strength of the soldier, he needs his eyes so he can be vigilant. He needs his ears so that he can listen to instruction and obey instruction. If a soldier has sight problem, he's almost getting disqualified out of the army. If he has hearing problem, he's almost out of the army. You must not have hearing problem. My sheep must still hear my voice. And then you must still be following and obeying. It's in obedience that is victory. And then R is resisting. And we have a lot to resist. One, we resist the devil. You know, the devil is always coming to try you. He's always coming to deceive you. And he's always saying, you are the worst pastor that ever lived on the face of the earth. Look at the work you are doing. You think that God will reward you? It's all a waste of time. That's the devil. Resist him. And he's saying, even your messages, your messages cannot get any soul saved. It's a lie. Don't you listen to the testimonies of members of your church? Oh, that say, I thank God. Before I came to this church, I didn't know Jesus as my personal Savior. But now I thank God. Because through listening to you and responding to that altar call, now I know Jesus as my personal Savior. Resist the devil. He will try to deceive you as if you are not doing any good at all, as if you are not preaching the gospel at all. He will try to discourage you. But not only resisting the devil, You see this flesh that we carry about. If we have any enemy at all, this flesh is an enemy. When this flesh is getting hungry, the flesh will say, why are you following God again? Why are you still preaching the gospel? Here you are hungry. Why not sell your birthright like Esau so you can have some pottage? When you are thirsty, this flesh will begin to cry out again and say, this is too much. If this is what the call of God means upon me, upon the body, I don't want you to be in the call of God. If you try to pray and fast at 11 o'clock in the morning, 11 o'clock, the body is crying again. And he's saying, food, 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 food. And you try to read Bible. Your body cries out for food. You try to pray. Your body cries out for food. And then somebody that did not remember that you existed when you were not fasting, he will prepare good food. And it's on that day of fasting, and he will say, something spoke to me to come and bring pastor food. And your body will say, here it is, here it is, here it is, now, let's eat. And you will say, I'll fast tomorrow. That thing is cancelled. Another 6 months will pass, there will be no time to fast. The flesh resists that thing. Then temptation. You know, sometimes people don't understand. You have a wife at home, but you know the wife. You see her when she is not dressing properly. She is working in the kitchen. Why should a person dress her best in the kitchen? Everybody dresses normally and a little bit rough in the kitchen. And you see her before she takes her bath. Her hair is not all well arranged. You see her while she is tired and worn out and yawning. Have you watched people when they yawn? They look ugly when they yawn. That's why we cover our mouth when we yawn, because it makes us look ugly. And you see your wife while she is tired and yawning. You know when you see other women, you see them when they are well dressed, when they set their hair properly, when they do everything well, and the flesh will say, look at them, they are more beautiful than your wife. No, they are not more beautiful. Only that you see your wife at the wrong time, you see them at the right time. You see them when they are well dressed, and they are deliberately dressing that way to attract the outsider. But your wife says, after all, he is my husband. And whether I'm in the kitchen or not, I look beautiful to her, to him. And the devil begins to tell you, look at your wife. Have you ever watched women when they are pregnant? And they suffer a lot, and they don't look as beautiful as they are ordinarily. And then you see all those other women outside. They look charming. They look smart. They look well dressed. And they look as if they have extra money to take care of themselves. And the devil will come and say, you see them? They are better than your wife? No. If your wife has the money that she had, If you can supply the same clothes that they have, your wife too will look more beautiful than they. They have maids at home that are cooking for them. They just sit on rocking chair watching television. If your wife also has a maid that will put water in the bathroom for her, do all the cooking for her, and have also some people to take care of the children, and not be pregnant every year to have children. Because when a woman has 7 children, 8 children, we should salute that woman. And if you too can make them rest a little, give them enough money, oh yes, they'll be more beautiful than those people you see outside. But thank God our wives are not complaining. And when you think they complain, they are not complaining as they could have complained. They don't have enough money to even feed. And whenever they cook that little meal, they say, my husband, evangelist or pastor, must eat first. Those people you see outside that you say they are beautiful, they eat first, and then the husband takes what remains. And so your wife is beautiful. How did you marry her? With your eyes closed? No, with your eyes open. You saw they were beautiful, that's how you married them. Now, if they don't look beautiful now, it's not their fault. Whose fault is it? Whose fault is it? The husband? Who are those husbands? Okay, it's our fault. So let's take care of them and resist temptation that will make us to feel that those other women outside are more beautiful. If you saw what they were covering with the clothes they wear, you'll run away from them. I want you to say, I thank God for my wife. I thank God for my wife. Those of you who are not married, I don't know what to tell you to say. Okay, I thank God I'll marry a good wife. Let's know that our wives are beautiful. Remember victory, vigilance, instruction, consecration and commitment, trust in the Lord, obedience, resisting the devil and resisting the flesh. Why is yielding to the Spirit of God? That's how to have the victory. As the Spirit of the Lord is talking to us and ministering to us, we yield to the leading of the Spirit of God. Now, the source of inner strength, looking into all those things that we have said now on having the victory, let's just briefly mention these points. Number one, make Christ your Savior, also your support. Be intimate in fellowship with the Savior, in communion with your shepherd, in all the steps you are taking. Always ask the Lord, what next do I do? Even messages that we're preaching, pray about those messages. Be intimate with the Lord. Make Christ, who is your Savior, also your support. Number two, have a strong conviction on spiritual and eternal issues. Conviction. on spiritual and eternal issues. Very quickly, I want to give you areas where you must have strong, unshakable conviction. Something you must never have any doubt about. Number one, have a strong conviction on your own call. Your call, the call of the Lord upon your life. Be sure about it. Know that God has called you a preacher, a pastor, a teacher, an evangelist. Know that this is the only thing in life that can make you happy. That if you deviate and you do any other thing as your number one priority thing in life, you will not be completely happy. Add that unchanging, unshakable conviction. I am sure the Lord called me. And he called me to do this work. Now you see, when you are sure of the call of God, if difficulty comes in that call, you will not leave that thing. Everybody has difficulty. The student has difficulty at school. But he knows, if I'm going to have anything in life, I must go through this difficulty and succeed. Be sure of your call. In John chapter 15, verse 16, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. I have chosen you. Number two, have a strong conviction on Christ being the only Savior. There is no alternative. Acts chapter 4, verse 12. There is no other name given among men whereby we can be saved. Number three, have a strong conviction on the Bible as being the Word of God. There is no other revelation. Number one, be sure of your call. What I'm doing now is the important thing, the priority of my life. No other profession to take my time. Be sure of Christ as a Savior. There is no alternative. He is the only one that can save. Be sure of the Bible as the Word of God. There is no other revelation. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. All scripture is given by inspiration and is good for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Now be sure of the experience of salvation. There is no other passport to heaven. And in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Now be sure of the end of a sinful life, judgment at the end of a sinful life. For those unbelievers, that will motivate you and push you and drive you to go and preach to them. It is hell fire at the end of an unrepentant life. There is no escape. Let me show this and think about this a lot. There is only one life. If you misspend it, there is no duplicate you can spend again and make right what has been wrong. Your call There's no other profession, no other priority in your life. Christ, no other Savior. There is no alternative. The Bible, there's no other revelation. Salvation is the only passport to heaven. There is no other passport. And if people die in sin, there is no escape from the judgment of God. And you have only one life. There is no duplicate. Spend it for God. If you have conviction on these important things, it will give you courage and conviction and commitment to stay on that job. How do I maintain constant boldness and courage? Number one, by prayer. Acts chapter 4, verses 31 to 33. Number two, by faith. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 27. By faith he forsook Egypt, and he behaved as seeing him that is invisible. Number three, fellowship with God. Without me ye can do nothing. John chapter 15, verse 5. Number four, association with dynamic ministers of the gospel. Proverbs 27, verse 17. Iron sharpness iron. Number five, let there be real deep study of the word of God. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 5. Knowledge brings strength. Number six, dedication to service. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 9. Woe is me if I preach not the gospel. And love for the work and love for those who are trying to win. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. And because ye were dear unto us, we shared with you not only the gospel of Christ, but our own very souls, being affectionately desirous of you. How did those men in the Bible maintain their courage and boldness in the Lord? They prayed a lot. They believed in the Lord. They had continual intimate fellowship with God. They associated with other ministers of the gospel. Like this meeting we're having together. Associating with one another, encouraging one another, praying for one another, even writing letters of encouragement to one another after we have left this meeting. Then they studied a lot. They were dedicated to the service. And there was great love for the work in their hearts. The engineer loves his work. The doctor loves his work. The university lecturer loves his work. And the market women love their work. Those traders love their works. The cattle rearer loves his work. We must also love our work. Why shouldn't we be happy in what we're doing? You find people that rise up and they say, I'm an engineer. And then the doctor rises up, I'm a doctor. The lecturer rises up and he says, I'm a lecturer. And the pastor is thinking, what will I say when it comes to my turn? Aren't you happy you are a pastor? Aren't you happy you are what you are? Be confident and rise up also and say, I'm a pastor, a preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Love it and do it. Keep on doing it and loving it. And on the day of your death, if possible, keep on preaching the gospel until that time. And when we get to heaven, you will know the work you did was the greatest work you could have done on the face of the earth. It's good to be a doctor. It's good to be an engineer. It's good to be a professional person. It is best to be a preacher of the gospel. I believe from what we have heard today, God will grant every one of us to have courage for victory in our service. At last, I finished. Aren't you happy I could stop? Now we'll rise up and we'll pray. And we'll thank the Lord for what He has spoken to us. And we'll commit ourselves to the Lord that we will be courageous in the work of the Lord. And we will retain the victory. We'll retain the victory.
your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know. And the way ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also, and from henceforth ye know him and have seen him. Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus saith unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me. Or else, believe me for the very works' sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If ye love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me. Because I live, ye shall live also. And that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself to him. Judas saith unto him, not Iscariot, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us, and not unto the world? Jesus answered and said unto him, If a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him, and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If ye loved me, ye would rejoice, because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it is come to pass, ye might believe. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh, and hath nothing in me. But that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so I do. Arise, let us go hence.
May God bless his word in our hearts in Jesus' name. We shall listen to choir song.
after my sins were forgiven, I started out for higher ground to climb the ladder rung by rung. Yes, I'm climbing higher and higher, and I won't come down. The first rung was regeneration,
still climbing.
The second, justification,
still climbing.
The third, the happy confession, session. The fourth round was sore tribulation that leads your soul to glorification. Well, I'm climbing higher and higher, and I won't come down. I'm gonna climb till I pass the sun, moon, and stars, Jupiter, Venus, Neptune, and Mars. I bid farewell to these old hours of clay, but then I'll go a running down the Milky White Way. I'm so high, I'll never come down. Still climbing round by round, climbing for higher ground. I'm climbing round by round, I'm so high.
Today is the last Sunday of the month. By the grace of the Lord, we shall listen to the message from Ben. Okay, first. And God is going to bless us as we are listening in Jesus' name.
Let us pray. Father God in heaven, we bless your name. Father, we thank you for the message that we heard this morning. Lord in heaven, as we take this journey, Father, we are winners. Lord in heaven, we are conquerors. Lord in heaven, we cannot win without fighting. How can you win? The only way you win is to continue to fight. And Father, Lord in heaven, we are fighters and we'll never give up. Lord in heaven, we know that we fight but spirits, but because you are with us, Father, Lord in heaven, we win. And Father, we're looking up to heaven. Lord in heaven, as we're going to listen to your word this morning, Father, may we be blessed. May our souls be lifted, Father God in heaven. The angels will come here and your word will come down straight from heaven to your children. Because you love us. And that's why you sent your son Jesus to come and suffer, to be chastised, and to take away our sorrow. Father, Lord in heaven, for today we have no sorrow. Father, our pains have been taken away because we are looking up to heaven. Lord, we bless your name. We bless you, Lord, because you are the one who loved us first, before we even thought about loving you. Father, we know you continue to love us until you. The end times. We bless your name. We pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. You are once again welcome in Jesus' name. May we all be seated. I know that the last time I stood here, I spoke about, I know, as being the problem of us in the church, in fact, even the human race. We saw how it started with Adam and Eve when the devil told them that you will know. And I said that it was the greatest sermon of my life, and I meant it. And I still encourage each and every one of you to go and meditate about that word, I know. You know, you look at somebody's face, yeah, I know him or her. He or she is a deceiver. But I'll tell you that today you're a winner. You're a conqueror. The reason is that, you know, I was listening to a song that was sung in my language. It says that it's similar to the song, I am a winner in the Lord Jesus. Are you a winner? Are you a winner? Are you a winner? Praise the Lord. So it says that even with hardship, we should be happy and glad because we are the ones who are winning. If you are not winning today, I will tell you that you need to know that you are winning. Amen? The reason why I said that you are winning is because of the fact that you're still walking with the Lord Jesus. You know, as our pastor gave testimony this morning, if you are not winning, you wouldn't have been here in the church. You'll have left. Amen? I encourage each and every one of you. And I want you to know that you have conquered. And you continue to conquer. That even when the enemy brings things against you, our Father in heaven, because of the Spirit, he has given me and you. You always win. That is not the title of our message today. The title of our message today is The Call to Walk with Jesus. The Call to Walk with Jesus. How are you walking with Jesus? We will see how you are walking with Jesus, and we see how our Father in heaven has asked us to walk with Jesus. It begins with when you are born again. You ask a question and, you know, nobody needs to answer, but if anyone wants to answer, they can. How are you walking with Jesus? Nobody needs to answer, but if anyone wants to answer, you can go ahead and answer. How are you walking with Jesus? The title of the message today is The Call to Walk with Jesus. You become called to walk with Jesus when the message is preached to you. Amen? When somebody meets you, the day that the message is preached to you and you accept Jesus as your personal Savior, Lord and Savior, you are called to walk with Jesus. And my belief is that everyone seated here is already called to walk with Jesus. But the question is, how are you walking with Jesus? The call to walk with Jesus. We will see how some of us walk with Jesus, and we'll see how the Bible wants us to walk with Jesus. Let's look at Matthew chapter 14, verse 25. We'll read to 29. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them. No, I'm sorry. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. We'll come back to Matthew chapter 14. That is the text of the message. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verse 38. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verse 38. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, Repent, and be ye baptized, every one of you, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. That is the first step. The first step, like Peter said, repent of your sin. So if you have repented of your sin, it means you have been called to walk with Jesus. If you have repented of your sin, let's look at John chapter 3, verse 3. If you have repented, it means you have been called to walk with Jesus. The question is that, how are you walking with Jesus? John chapter 3, verse 3. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I said unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So, to be called to walk with Jesus first again, you have to be born again. Christ is the Son of God, and the earth is not his kingdom. So, for you to walk with him and be prepared to go to his house, because when you have a friend who is very close to you, you go to the person's house, right? So for you to walk with Jesus and to be allowed to visit Jesus' house, that is heaven. He says, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That's the kingdom of his Father. That is the house of Jesus. You know, you have a son, a daughter who say, well, you know, I'm going to my friend's house. For you to visit the house of Jesus, you have to be born again. To walk with Jesus, you need to be born again, because Jesus will walk with you to his house. You have to be born again. John chapter 5, verse 24 to 25. John chapter 5, verse 24 to 25. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. The woman said unto him, John chapter 5, verse 24. So, God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. How the call to walk with Jesus. Amen, my brothers and sisters. The call to walk with Jesus. John chapter 3, verse 16 to 17. 3:16-17. For God so loved the world. It's a popular verse, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Our Father so loved the world. So to walk with Jesus, to walk with him, you have to believe in him. You have to believe in Jesus. So first of all, I believe everyone here is born again. Anyone who is listening to the message that is not born again, you need to be born again to walk with Jesus. And if you want to, so when you are born again to walk with Jesus, so you walk with him, he's inviting you to his Father's house. But for you to be able to make it to his Father's house, there's a condition. And what is the condition? The condition is that, if we look at 5:24, God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The call to walk with Jesus. You have to be born again to be able to walk with Jesus. Let's look at Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. I'll always like to refer to the Bible. By doing that, there is no mistake, because then the word is coming directly from the word of God. Amen. Everything is coming from heaven then. Praise the Lord. Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk ye in him. The call to walk with Jesus. I said, as you have received him, we need to walk in him. Again, the condition are, you have to be born again. You worship our Father in spirit. And as you have received Jesus into your life, he's expecting you to walk like that with him. The call to walk with Jesus. The precondition is you have to give your life to Christ to be able to walk with Jesus. So that call is the first day, the first time that word was preached to you, whether physically, whether you read the Bible, or it was on the radio, or on the TV, or a piece of paper that you got. That is a call. You have been called to walk with Jesus. The question is, my brothers and sisters, how are you walking with Jesus? How are you walking with Jesus? Are you walking with Jesus in spirit? Or are you walking with Jesus in fear? Are you walking with Jesus in truth? Because as we saw in the book of John, so as we read John chapter 5 verse 24, says that we need to walk in spirit. Amen. How are you walking with Jesus? Now we'll go to our main text. Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14, we'll read from verse 25 to 29. 25 to 29. And in the fourth watch of night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit. And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. We'll look at it again. Jesus was walking on the sea. Amen. The disciples were afraid. And he said, no, it's me. It's me, Jesus, walking on. So, the disciples that were with Jesus, he has called them to walk with him. Just as he has called us now with the word, when the word is preached to you, to walk with Jesus. And when Peter was come down out of the ship. No, sorry. And Peter said, answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. So now, Peter is saying, Christ, invite me to walk with you. When the word is preached to you, you are being invited to walk with Jesus. How are you walking with Jesus? It says, Peter says, I want the invitation. I want to walk with you. And he said, that is Jesus. Come. And Peter, when was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Amen? So when the invitation is given to you, whether you listen physically, somebody talking to you, or in the church, or somebody gave you a pamphlet, you know, you read the Bible, somebody gave you a Bible in a hotel, or you watched the message on TV or radio, you are invited. You said, Father, forgive me of my sins. And Jesus says, come unto me, my child, you that is heavy laden, so that I can take away the pain, the sorrow, I'll take away everything from you. And you begin to walk with Jesus. The question is, how are you walking with Jesus? So, let's see now, how did Peter walk with Jesus? How did he walk with him when Christ said, come walk with me? But when he saw the wind boisterous, that is Peter, he was afraid. So when you start to walk with Jesus, when the temptations come, when the troubles come, so as the wind is blustering, Peter became afraid. You know, when the troubles come, when the temptations come, when the burdens come, you become afraid. Is that how Christ wants you to walk with him? Is that how Christ had wanted Peter to walk with him? He said, come walk with me. And Peter was eager. He ran onto the water and started to walk. You know, when you give your life to Christ, you're eager, you're pumped up, you have the Spirit. You know, you're singing hallelujah, you forget about everything. But then as the storm comes, you know, the time that you give your life, maybe you have an ailment that's been worrying you, that disappears, everything is gone, you're feeling hype, you're feeling excited, everything's working good with you. But when the troubles come, like it came to Peter, and it says, verse 30, but when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. He became afraid. When the troubles come, when the burdens come, you become afraid. And see what happens when you begin to walk with Jesus and you become afraid. You know, Christ said, thou of little faith. When your faith lingers, let's see what happened to Peter. He was afraid and began to sink. He became afraid and he began to sink. The call to walk with Jesus. How are you walking with Jesus? Are you walking with Jesus in fear? Are you walking with Jesus in fear? Are you Peter today? Are you Peter today that when the troubles come, then you become afraid and you waver instead of looking unto Christ? Because you're sinking, everything seems to be falling apart. And then you begin to waver. You began to be afraid instead of having faith. You know, the thought of Peter in his head, it is because he looked, oh, I'm actually walking on water. And the wind, because the wind is blowing, is shaking. If Peter was looking at Jesus while he was walking and not thinking about the wind that is blowing, he wouldn't have started sinking. On solid rock I stand, all other grounds are sinking sand. All other grounds are sinking sand. If Peter had looked unto Jesus, saying that I am standing on the solid rock, I'm looking onto the solid rock, that every other ground is sinking sand, Peter wouldn't have begun to sink. Are you today, because of the storm, instead of looking unto Jesus, dedicating everything to him and having faith, you begin to waver? You begin to change the way that you do things. I will tell you, my brothers and sisters, it means you're leaving the solid rock and going into the sinking sand, and you begin to sink, just like Peter began to sink. How are we supposed to walk with Jesus? How are we supposed to walk with Jesus? The Bible says, we'll open Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, we'll read verse 16 to 17. Before we go to Galatians, we'll read Romans chapter 13, verse 13. Amen? The walk, how are you walking with Jesus? How has he called us to walk with him? It says, let us walk honestly, as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying. How are you walking in Jesus? The instruction is, how do we need to walk in Jesus? He's saying, let us walk honestly. Are you walking honestly? As in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying. Is that your life? Are you envying other brethren? Are you striving with others? It says, as in the day. You know, it's comparing the day you see. So the day you see, your eyes, you see everything. Because if you walk in the dark, you don't see. Amen. You are feeling everywhere and you don't know where you are. He is saying that you should walk, that your eyes are open. That you, when you're a child of God, Christ is calling you to walk with your eyes open. And let me tell you something. I'll tell you something. The reason why I do not allow anger or whatever issue it is to overtake me is that when I put my mind to that, when I get upset, I lose my sense of thinking. And Christ is telling me and you, that you should walk in the day. Your sin, it means that you should always walk in your right senses, no matter what it is. It's saying that, it says, walk in honesty. Honestly. You know, see, this is my nature. That when you're close to me, I trust you 100%. When you betray me, it's very, very difficult. It's very, very difficult for me to see you with that eyes. It takes me time. I'm just saying it. It is very difficult. It takes me time to bring you back to that spot. The scriptures is saying that we should walk honestly. So let's look at it, even us as human beings, that when we don't walk honestly with one another, there's mistrust. How much more God who created me and you, how do you want God to trust you? You know, today I'm telling Pastor Matthew something different. Tomorrow I'm telling the same thing. I'm telling Brother Stephen a different story. And then I'm telling my wife on the same topic, a different story. And then I'm telling Brother Stephen's wife, a different story. So if you guys all hear, how can you ever trust what I say? How can you? I'm just being honest here. See, the reason why I'm being honest is like, we see Christianity as, you know, some kind of difficult thing to follow. No, God has given us example here on earth. Look, if you cannot be honest with your human brothers and sisters, you can never be honest with God. You cannot. I'm telling you, I'm not joking. You know, if you don't have faith here on earth, if you don't have faith on a brethren here on earth, I know that our Father in heaven said we should trust in God. We shouldn't trust in our fellow human beings because they'll only disappoint us. But we have to have the faith, because if we don't have the faith that because the spirit of our Father in heaven is in that brother, is in that sister, so I can trust them, it becomes difficult to trust God that you've never seen. Who has seen God? Let me say it again. I know the scripture says that, you know, we trust only in God because our fellow human beings will fail us. But do you know why I would trust in a brother or sister in Christ? It's because the Spirit of God is in that person. Because if not, how can I do business with brethren in the house of God? How can I fellowship with you in the house of God? You know, how can I trust that you're even born again? I am not trusting the human person you're seeing, but I'm trusting the spirit in that person. Amen? I'm telling the Father in heaven that, look, I don't trust that flesh I'm seeing, but I trust your spirit that you have put in that person. That's all I'm trusting. Amen? It says, with not rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying. You know, I come to church and I see Brother Demetrius' glasses, and I'm saying, that glasses looks good. How come mine looks bad? I should have a better glasses than he has. No, the Father in heaven is telling that the way we walk with Jesus is that we walk with no envy, no strife. You know, I'm praying for that brother. I'm praying for that sister. You guys are praying for me also, that whatever that I'm going through, that the Father in heaven will uplift me out of it and make me better. That is how we are being called to walk with Jesus. How are you walking with Jesus? That's the question that I'm asking you. The call to walk with Jesus. How are you walking with Jesus? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Then we'll go to Galatians 5:16. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. For we are his workmanship, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. So, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk in them. The Father in heaven is telling us how we need to walk, because we are his workmanship. You know what workmanship is? You know, when you make, if you're a plumber, a carpenter, you know, you make chairs. You know, you look at the chair, that's the brand of, they say that chair is that person's brand. You know, that's Benjamin's brand. It's reliable. So because we're the workmanship of our Father in heaven, we are created in Jesus Christ. When you become born again, you become the workmanship of the Father. So he has created you in Jesus Christ, the rubber stamp. So, in Jesus Christ, unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk in them. Unto good works. How are you walking with Jesus? Are people doubting you? Can people trust you? Can people trust you? Can people trust the way that you walk? Are you walking in Christ the way you're supposed to? How are you walking in Jesus? Let's look at Galatians chapter. How does our Father in heaven expect us to walk with him? How? We've seen how Peter walked in fear. And what happened to Peter? What happened to Peter? And what was Peter supposed to do? So when you walk in Jesus and you stumble and there's a problem, what should be the answer? How are we supposed to walk in Christ? Walk with Jesus. Galatians 5, 16 to 17. Galatians 5, 16 to 17. Says, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. He's saying, how are we supposed to walk? Walk in the Spirit. And why? So that we will not fulfill what? The lust of the flesh. Even though you are born again, you have the Spirit of God in you. So you are two, right? You have the Spirit of God and you have the flesh. And our Father is saying, see, it is the scriptures I'm reading from. It's not coming from me. Saying that, look, you have the Spirit and you have the flesh. Anger is not coming from the Spirit. Anger comes from the flesh. He's saying that you should walk in the Spirit, because when you walk in the Spirit, the flesh will be gone. Amen? That is how we are being asked to walk with Jesus. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are the contrary, the one to the other, so that ye cannot do things that ye would. Amen? But if ye are led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Amen? He's telling you that, look, it is a continuous battle. That is why I sang the song, I am a winner. In the Lord Jesus, are you a winner? I am a winner. In the Lord, are you a winner? Are you a winner? Why did I sing the song to say, are you a winner? Because you're saying that you have won because you refuse to walk in the flesh. You're always walking in the Spirit. And if you walk in the Spirit, we've seen that earlier on that we read, because it's commanded by God, that we read in John chapter 5, verse 24. When you walk in the Spirit, then you're walking with Jesus. That's how you're expected to walk with Jesus. My brothers and sisters, I have read, if you do not walk in the Spirit, what happens to you? We'll go back to Matthew 14, 31. If you do not walk in Spirit, we're asked to walk, if you walk in fear, because Peter walked in fear. But if you walk in the Spirit and not walk in, he was walking in the flesh and in fear. That is why he began to sink. He allowed the flesh to overcome the Spirit. He began to walk in the flesh. he began to sink. Amen. But you are told to walk in the Spirit. So let's see. Matthew chapter 14, I'm almost done. I think our time is well spent. Am I looking at the time correctly? It should be past 11, right? Okay, praise the Lord. I thought that I was, it was to 12. Amen. So let's look at Matthew chapter 14, verse 31. Are we following? And immediately Jesus stretched, but when he saw the wind blustering, he was afraid. He became afraid because, as we have just read now, that if you walk in the flesh will take over. But if you walk in the Spirit, that's how we're supposed to walk in the Spirit. If you begin to walk in the flesh, because he began to walk on the with the flesh. In the flesh, he began to see the storm. And then he remembered, I'm walking on water. But if he was looking unto Jesus and walking in Spirit, he wouldn't ever see the storm. You know, as you do, as